I must admit that I have a very special place in my heart for Neptune. The reason is that when I first became interested in astronomy in the mid-1980s, we had never seen Neptune close up. It was the one giant planet left that we hadn't visited, and all we could see of it was a somewhat blurry disk in telescope images. Not high resolution, for sure. We knew some things about it, but no one really expected just what we would find in the Neptune system in 1989. Back in the mid-80s, I remember Voyager 2 was on its way to Neptune, and in just a few short years, we would get a close-up set of pictures of that distant ice giant. And we did. The images were nothing short of stunning, with Neptune sporting a great storm or depression in its atmosphere along with white clouds. Its moons did not disappoint, with Triton showing very obvious and active cryovolcanism, ice volcanoes spewing material into the sky, as well as taking its place as a candidate for a liquid ocean ice shell moon, though whether it actually is one is unclear to this day. But as far as the exploration of Neptune went by robotic probe, Voyager 2's flyby remains all we've ever done, and while Uranus has returned to the radar for a possible probe in the relatively near term, Neptune remains somewhat neglected, despite being one of the stranger, least understood worlds in the solar system. We will have to make do with telescope observations for a while, which with JWST and Hubble and the new group of very large telescopes, this has gotten better. In fairness, part of the problem is that Neptune is currently rather hard to get to with our methods of slingshotting probes through close planetary passes. Direct flights take a lot more energy, though today's class of giant rockets, such as NASA's SLS and SpaceX Starship, bring that more into the realm of doability. But hidden in this story is an odd possibility. We almost didn't get to see Uranus or Neptune at all, and it's conceivable that had the wrong events happened during the Voyager missions, we may have missed it for lack of funding. The Voyager missions took advantage of the possibility of a grand tour of the outer solar system. Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune happened to be in such a configuration that slingshotting between them was doable, a rare alignment. NASA naturally wanted to take advantage of this, so they drew up the Grand Tour Plan, which included all four outer giant worlds. But weirdly, the Grand Tour was initially overruled by US President Richard Nixon himself, who only wanted to do two of the planets, Jupiter and Saturn, and save the costs, apparently, and skip the other two, which made no sense because it was just getting further use out of a pair of spacecraft that were already going to be built. But as sometimes happens, the scientists kept the full Grand Tour in their pocket and designed the spacecraft with the full tour in mind, and just waited out the changes in administrations, and the tour went ahead with funding. This is not the first time that happened at NASA, building something to wait out the current status quo. The venerable and famous Saturn V rocket was another case. That rocket was not intended by Wernher von Braun to be solely a moon rocket. It was well capable of that and did so, but a different, smaller system would have worked in its stead. Rather, he stealthily intended Saturn V to be a Mars-capable rocket from the start. It was never used for that, but had history been different, we could have had human boots on Mars decades ago, perhaps by the 1980s or 90s. But in fairness, that may have been a dream too far in those days, because we knew much less about Mars back then, and it would have required a robust flurry of robotic space exploration that we have ultimately ended up doing slowly through subsequent probes. But we still need to know more even today. But it's a shame that we didn't keep the Saturn V around. We went to the moon with it and used it to launch Skylab, but then abandoned it with two unused rockets in storage, now on museum display, in favor of the less capable space shuttle. I liked the shuttle, I grew up with it, but in many ways it was not the best path to have gone. That aside, the Grand Tour was saved, and we saw Neptune up close for the first time in 1989. Neptune was discovered by Urbain Le Verrier in 1846, at least officially. Unofficially, Neptune had been seen by a number of astronomers, including Galileo, but dismissed as a fixed star, and there had been suspicions for years that something, an unseen large planet, was perturbing Uranus's orbit. Neptune is 17 times the mass of Earth, with a diameter about 4 times that of our planet. Its internal structure is similar in some ways to Uranus, so its atmosphere extends down between 10 to 20% of the way to the core. That number remains uncertain, which likely transitions into a mantle that has water, ammonia, and methane present. This layer is often referred to as ice, as an ice giant. But that's somewhat misleading because it's actually a hot, dense, supercritical fluid that has high electrical conductivity. There may also be a weird layer of ionic water there, where the water molecules are broken down into a soup of hydrogen and oxygen ions, which the deeper you go, the more it becomes super ionic water, where the oxygen crystallizes into a lattice, but the hydrogen just floats around in the mix, moving through the lattice. Weird high-pressure materials indeed. Below that may be a layer where methane gets crushed, forming diamonds, and even a diamond rain, possibly falling into a diamond-laden liquid carbon layer. Finally, there is probably a core of iron, nickel, and silicates, just a little larger than Earth, but very hot, almost 5,100 degrees Celsius. As if those basic attributes weren't odd enough, Neptune would go on to become a world of surprises that we only found out about because of Voyager 2. Voyager 1 did not complete the grand tour. It never went to Uranus or Neptune, but for a very good reason. It was deflected off that course to get a close look at Saturn's moon Titan, which turned out to be one of the most enigmatic bodies in the solar system. But for Neptune, it turns out that planet has inexplicably high winds. These winds reach up to 500 meters per second, four times anything measured at Jupiter. And in the upper altitudes, the winds can reach 1,770 kilometers per hour, faster than the speed of sound in Earth's atmosphere. Strong winds indeed, but it gets stranger. Not only that, but the winds are blowing the wrong way. Winds on planets tend, but not always, to blow eastward, meaning that they tend towards the direction the planet rotates. Not with Neptune. It's a contrarian, and its winds tend to be westward, against the rotation of the planet. It's also thought that these winds are layered, not unusual. But those layers are very thin, less than 600 miles thick, which means they may be driven by somewhat complicated moisture conditions, potentially accounting for their strength. But it remains that, it seems, that for something so distant from the sun, getting so little solar energy that far out, it is really active and hot, and hence it's something going on internally that makes it produce more heat than it receives from the sun, which in turn affects the weather. How that's organized remains unknown, and only further observations and missions to Neptune will answer it. Another mystery is Neptune's magnetic field, which in some ways makes no sense. This is a weird attribute that it also shares with Uranus. Both of them have seriously offset magnetic fields, very much unlike Jupiter and Saturn, and is one of many reasons we can't really call these worlds gas giants, rather ice giants, because a lot of what ice giants do, gas giants do not. So the magnetic field of Neptune is tilted 47 degrees to the planet's rotation. Uranus is in a similar position, which goes against how we normally think of planetary magnetic fields, and suggests that it's not something situational, like Uranus having gotten knocked on its side at some point in its history. Whatever it is, it's happening at Neptune too, so it seems to be something inherent to this class of planet. Usually magnetic fields are associated with movement and currents, basically churning of some type. With Earth, is the dynamo of molten metal doing it? Without that, the magnetic field would shut down, as has happened at other terrestrial planets. It's something sort of related for the gas giants, just convecting material generating it, though it's different materials and conditions involved. But it's entirely unclear how that could be so off-kilter with Neptune and Uranus, and it's not even clear how it could physically happen in the first place, but it does. And that bizarre offset makes for a wildly variable magnetic field that's all over the place due to the planet's rotation. There is something about the interior of Neptune that we do not know as to why and how it offsets its magnetic field like that. The next mystery requires a preface. This famous picture of Neptune from Voyager 2 actually isn't the right color. It was always known to be a false color image intended to increase contrast and the visibility of the planet's features. Recently, some researchers went back and restored the image to true color, and you can see Neptune's actual color and features aren't as vivid. But this is much closer to what you'd see from your spaceship when passing this planet. But you can still see the features, including one particularly enigmatic and striking feature that was the most prominent thing everyone noticed during the flyby, Neptune's Great Dark Spot. Superficially, it's a little bit similar to Jupiter's Great Red Spot, which led to the name. And immediately at the time, scientists started wondering how similar these two features were. Had the dark spot been there for centuries like the red spot? Was it a huge storm? It turns out, very likely no. It seems to have been a transient event, because when the Hubble Space Telescope came online and photographed Neptune in 1995, the spot had completely vanished. Then, another one seems to have formed up within a year, though the evidence for that spot suffered from poor resolution, because Neptune is so distant from Earth, and Hubble can only go so far with planet resolution, though it's still quite good. As to what the spot is and how it relates to Jupiter's spot is a different matter. The dark spot and the red spot appear to be two completely different weather phenomena, and in the case of the dark spot, the best explanation right now is that it's a darkening in a lower layer under a hazy upper layer that becomes visible for a time, and then disappears, and another one forms up, and so on. It's difficult to term it a storm, rather more like a splotch, but it is a really unusual weather feature that seems to happen at Neptune regularly, but for some reason, not at Uranus. Neptune's distance makes it difficult to study, and what we've seen so far has, like all the other worlds of the solar system, turned out to be far more complicated than we imagined, and presented a number of mysteries that to this day remain unsolved, since we first visited this world in 1989, completing the Grand Tour, and Voyager 2 heading out to explore the conditions at the edge of the solar system and the interstellar medium beyond, which it currently still does. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently explaining why I am not extensively talking about the moons of these planets in these deep dives of the planets of the solar system. The answer is simple. When I finish the planets, then come dedicated videos on the moons. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.